together for my good. And I know that all things work together for my good.
To Soar series. Oh, I'm so glad that you joined us this evening, and I have a great expectation for each of you tonight. I just know God is going to meet you right where you are. Now, please remember to visit our website, wotfd.com, and learn about how you can be a part of the International Face Down Prayer Movement. Also, while you're there, I invite you to just support this ministry by purchasing our books, our designer shirts, our hats, face masks, bracelets. We got a vast array of items for you to choose from. So please, please support the ministry. Thank you in advance for your support. We appreciate you so much. Now, you know the drill. Please take a moment before we get started and share this video. If everybody watching would just simply click the share button, hundreds of women outside of our class can potentially be empowered and uplifted. Won't you be a blessing to somebody? Just click share. So please share, share, and share again. All right, remember, each class is also available for viewing on our Women of Travail YouTube channel. So please feel free to review our sessions anytime and also invite a friend to view. This evening, we will continue to expound on the enormous ability that women possess. And we're going to examine a critical pivot in a woman's life named Abigail. But as we always do before we get started, let us approach the throne of grace and let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for another glorious day that you've allowed us to reside in the land of the living. God, we thank you for keeping us in our right minds. Thank you for a hunger and a thirst for righteousness. We thank you, God, for a desire to serve you and to serve your people. Lord, we ask you to anoint this class on this evening. Let your word and your message take root in our spirits. Let us not be simply hearers of the word, but let us also be doers of your word. Lord, continue to bless and prosper your women. And Lord, cause us to soar. In Jesus' name we pray. And the women of Travail agreed with this prayer by saying, amen. Proverbs 14:1 says that every wise woman builds her house, but the foolish woman plucks it down with her own hands. This scripture, women of God, lets us know that your success is not automatic. Although you were born to soar, if you don't operate in godly wisdom, your plane will never leave the runway. Women, you have the power to either build up or tear down. This means that when things fall apart in our lives, whether it's a wavered child, whether it's a troubled relationship, whether it's a stagnant ministry or a bad attitude, or even trouble on the job, whatever it is, if it affects your house, you have the ability to turn things around, but you got to rebuke your pride and be willing to accept responsibility. When things fall apart in our lives, the natural human flesh inclination is to immediately blame others. We naturally find some kind of way to deflect blame from ourselves, but the word of God says that you have the ability to correct any situation when you operate in God's wisdom. That means that you can make the situation worse or you can make it better. When things in our lives are out of control, when things are in disarray, our first response, it should be to search your own behavior. The first thing you should do is point your finger at your own self. Somebody say first. Now, this isn't an easy assignment because our flesh wants to puff up. Flesh wants to always be right. Your flesh wants things to go your way. Flesh don't want to acknowledge its own faults. Flesh would rather point out the faults of other people. But I'm a witness that sometimes good people make bad choices. And we gotta learn how to own up to the fact that as long as we're in flesh, we will have the opportunity to make mistakes. It doesn't make us bad people. It just means that from time to time, we mess up. I just heard God say to tell somebody, you need to forgive yourself. He said, let it go and move on. Forgive yourself and move on. Write this down. Everything bad that happens is not always somebody else's fault. We need to settle this right here, right now, from the get-go. Everything that happens bad is not always somebody else's fault. Now, the problem may have been caused by another person. However, if it affects your house, the Bible says that if you operate in wisdom, you have the power and the ability to bring restoration and peace. You got the ability to build your house up. Women of God, if you're going to soar in this season, you must be willing to own up to your own bad choices. You got to be willing to assume responsibility for every error. You got to redirect your behavior and implement godly wisdom and aggressively rebuild and restore your house. In 1 Samuel chapter 25, the Bible introduces a lady named Abigail. This little lady, she's one of my favorites because she knew how to build her house. The Bible says, I believe we're going to begin in 1 Samuel 25 verse 18. It says, then Abigail made haste and took 200 loaves and 2 bottles of wine and 5 sheep ready dressed and 5 measures of parched corn and 100 clusters of raisins and 200 cakes of figs, and she laid them on asses. And she said unto her servants, go on before me. Behold, I come after you. But she told not her husband, Nabal. And it was so as she rode on the ass that she came down by the covert of the hill. And behold, David and his men came down against her. And she met them. And when Abigail saw David, she hasted and lighted up the ass and fell before David on her face and bowed herself to the ground and fell at his feet and said, upon me, my Lord, upon me, let this iniquity be. And let thine handmaid, I pray thee, speak in thine audience and hear the words of thine handmaid. Verse 28, I pray thee, forgive the trespasses of thine handmaid, for the Lord will certainly make my Lord a sure house, because my Lord fighteth the battles of the Lord, and evil hath not been found in thee all thy days. Man, this is some powerful word. Okay, let's play this out in layman's terms, if you will. Here's how the story went down. There's this rich man named Nabal, who the Bible says was vulgar, says he was evil. And then there is his wife, Abigail, who the Bible says was the polar opposite of her husband. She was beautiful and compassionate, and she was kind. Now, David's men protected Nabal's flock, or in essence, they protected Nabal's money, if you will, from being stolen when they were out in the field. And in return, David asked for food, but Nabal dished David and refused to give him anything. So David's flesh rose up and he got mad. And he got his men all together and they set out to kill everybody in Nabal's camp. Meanwhile, one of the servants goes to Abigail, Nabal's wife, and he lets her know everything that's getting ready to go down. He lets her know run by run what just happened. Then Abigail secretly made the decision to personally deliver food to David and his men, in spite of her husband's stupidity. Abigail refused to allow Nabal's ignorance to destroy her family. She didn't fuss at her husband, tell him how dumb and stupid and ignorant he was. Abigail didn't gather all of her family and friends together and tell them how her husband had set a death trap for them. No. Abigail, she didn't get depressed and begin murmuring and complaining. Abigail simply kept silent. She kept her mouth shut and she walked in divine wisdom. She didn't allow her circumstances to make her negative and bitter. In fact, even though she had absolutely nothing to do with what her husband had did, she didn't have nothing to do with that mess he had made. The Bible says that Abigail took full responsibility. She fell on her face at David's feet and she asked for forgiveness. Man, I could preach right there. Listen, over and over and over again in scripture, when people really needed a miracle, when they needed the favor of God, they knew how to humble themselves, get on their face before God, and plead their case. Women, don't ever underestimate the power of face down prayer. Abigail, she was a wealthy woman. She was a beautiful woman. She was all the things that puff some people up. But I can imagine that she was also a most miserable woman. Because who in their right mind want to be yoked with a fool? Huh? But despite her circumstances, Abigail kept her cool. She treated all of her servants with respect and dignity. She was fair to everybody. And God ended up taking good care. Somebody say good care of Abigail. Let's finish the story. Let's go to 1 Samuel 25 and 38. And it reads, "And it came to pass about 10 days after that the Lord smote Nabal that he died. And when David heard that Nabal was dead, he said, blessed be the Lord that hath pleaded the case of my reproach from the hand of Nabal and hath kept his servant from evil. For the Lord hath returned the wickedness of Nabal unto his own hand. David sent and communed with Abigail to take her to him to wife. And Abigail, she hasted." That means she hurried up and got out of there. "She rose and she rode upon an ass with 5 damsels of her that went after her. And she went after the messenger of David and became David's wife." My, won't the Lord hook you up? Somebody say, yes, he will. Listen, Nabal was a fool, but Abigail's wisdom and her humility preserved her house. Her quick thinking and her ability to follow God's directions saved her life and the lives of her people. Scripture says that God killed her evil husband, Nabal, and freed her to remarry the king of Israel. Now, I want to note here that the Bible says that 5 damsels went with Abigail. She took some people with her. She took her girls with her. Women of Travail, when you yoke up with the right people, people who are anointed, people who are busy working in the kingdom, people who don't sit around and gossip and complain, people who are not always finding fault with others, people who are kind and compassionate, when you yoke up with people who are prayerful and wise, when you associate yourself with those kinds of people, that anointing will rub off on you. God will bless you and he will elevate you. What am I trying to say, Lady Golder? I'm saying treat your leaders with respect. Serve your leaders well, because the anointing flows from the top down. Understand that Abigail and her girls, they went from living in a really nice tent to living in a really, really nice castle. All because Abigail knew how to build her house. Abigail's story reminds me of a pearl. Pearls can only be formed in the oyster when sand and dirt seeps inside the oyster's shell. Now, these particles, they irritate the oyster, but the irritation is what actually produces a substance that creates the pearl. Listen, Abigail was irritated with her husband. We know she was. She was irritated with her living situations. She was irritated because she was about to be killed for something that she had nothing to do with. But Abigail allowed her irritation to produce a plan that created her deliverance. Always remember, your trouble doesn't come to destroy you. Your irritants, they come to develop that precious jewel that lies within you. Don't allow your flesh, don't allow your pride to get in the way of what God is trying to do in and through your life. Proverbs 11 and 2 tells us that when pride comes, then comes shame, but with the lowly is wisdom. Women, let me let you have this for free. For the rest of your life, you will have to battle your flesh, because the enemy will do anything and everything that he can do to try to cause your flesh to rise up. A few years ago, I was in my office when I received a call from a lady who said that she was calling to apologize to me. It's in the book. Get the book and read the whole thing. She said that she lived in another state and that I didn't know her, but when she was going through a very, very rough time in her life, she said a friend of hers gave her my book Face Down to read. The lady said that she looked at my picture that's on the back cover of the book. She said she immediately told her friend, "Can't nobody looking like that tell me nothing." And then she politely gave the book back to her friend. The lady went on to tell me that things got so bad in her life until she called her friend and she requested to read my book. She said that after she read the book and began praying face down, she said she was totally delivered from her torment. She said that she wanted to thank me for helping her through that very difficult time in her life. Now, here's where I'm going to have to be completely transparent with you. As the lady poured out all of her apologies and poured out her appreciation, I had so many different emotions going through my flesh. My flesh was just rising up. Now, I was hurt because I'd been judged by my appearance. I was sad that some people still view earrings and makeup as sin. But I was glad that the face down prayer had helped this woman. I gotta confess that my flesh and my pride wanted to hang the phone up right on that woman while she was talking. But I rebuked those feelings and I graciously accepted her apology. Now, a few months later, a call came into my office requesting that I come and speak for a Women's Day service. And they requested, now hear this, they said, "But when you come, please don't wear no earrings and don't wear no makeup." Okay, here we go again. I could feel pride rising up again. And my first thought was not to accept that engagement. But Holy Spirit spoke to me once again and said, "This is not about you. It's about my kingdom. Don't abort your purpose." So again, I had to swallow my pride. Now, I want you to fast forward several months later. When I went to speak at this engagement, I was greeted by a woman who introduced herself by saying, "I'm the same lady who called you a few months ago to apologize." She said she was the president of the women's ministry at this church and that she was the one responsible for me being there to preach. She went on to share that her church was under a great spiritual attack and that they really needed help. I found out later that the ministry had undergone a horrific transition. Several years prior, after one of the services had concluded at this church, the pastor of the church was gunned down and killed in the church sanctuary. This devastation of this tragedy lingered, and feelings of unrest hovered over the members of the ministry. Listen, women of God, God wanted to use me to bring deliverance to his people, but the enemy tried to use my pride to block what God was going to do through me. The enemy wanted me to get all caught up in my emotions, wanted me to get caught up in my hurt and my feelings, and to embrace the spirit of offense and be rude to that lady. The enemy wanted me to decline the ministry request. But, listen, I don't care if they said don't wear no makeup and earrings. It wasn't about me. I can wear makeup and earrings when I get home. Women of Drive, pride is a vicious beast that you will have to constantly chain for the rest of your natural born life. You got to consistently tell your flesh no. Consistently tell your flesh, stop, sit down, shut up. If you don't, flesh will take over and ultimately it will destroy you. Another time that my pride almost took me down was when I was asked to speak on a Sunday morning for a very traditional Baptist church. Now, this church didn't have a pastor at the time, so the deacons were in charge. Somebody say, uh-oh, that should have been a red flag right there. After I arrived to the church, I was ushered into the sanctuary by one of the younger deacons. Service had already started, and the sanctuary was full of people. And as the deacon escorted me to the pulpit, he motioned for me to sit in a chair where the pastor would have sat if they had had a pastor. You know, that big chair that's in the center, right behind the podium. Well, I refused. Had enough sense not to sit in that chair, whether they had a pastor or not. I insisted on sitting in one of the small chairs on either side. After several seconds of trying to coerce me to sit in the big chair, the deacon finally let me sit in the small chair. Now, after I sat down, I looked out over the audience to see if I knew anybody in the congregation. I wanted to see if any of the saints from my church had showed up to support me. Well, I noticed the older man sitting on the front row, and he was pointing his finger at me and fussing at the young deacon who had just ushered me into the pulpit. After their exchange, the younger deacon comes up to me and says that the older deacon who was fussing was a senior deacon, and he was angry because I was sitting on the pulpit. He said that some of the traditional people in the church did not believe in women preachers. Now, here goes my flesh. The first thing that went through my mind was, y'all should have figured all of this mess out before you even invited me to come preach. That's the first thing that came to my mind. But I kept my mouth shut as I was removed from the pulpit and placed in a chair off on the side of the church by the door. The younger deacon, oh, he was so sweet and apologetic. And he explained, as he apologized, he explained that I'd have to sit on the side and I have to preach from a little podium, a little lectern, if you will, that would be on the floor in front of the offering table. Couldn't even preach from the pulpit. As I gathered my Bible in my purse, y'all, my flesh rose all the way up. My feelings were crushed. I was so embarrassed that I could hardly push my tears back. And after I was placed in my chair, my new seat, if you will, several people from the congregation, they began to come up to me and they hugged me and embraced me, and they were actually crying because they disapproved of this deacon's behavior. And as I sat in my chair and received all the love from the congregation, man, then I really started feeling sorry for myself. And these are the thoughts that went through my mind. I thought, why was I even invited when they knew there'd be such opposition? I thought, why did that deacon try to sit me in the big chair when he knew they didn't even want me in the pulpit, period? on the side in the first place? Why put me on the pulpit and then go through all of that embarrassment of getting me up and moving me to the side? And the more I thought, the angrier I got. Something whispered in my ear and said, you need to get up out of this chair, walk straight down the aisle, walk out that front door, get in your car, and go to your own church where you don't have to deal with all of this religious mess. Listen, this is for all the saints who think that you're so saved that the only person that speaks to you is God. That's a lie straight from the pit of hell. How do I know? I know it's a lie because if the devil talked to Jesus, the devil will talk to us with our saved selves. I know I'm saved. And the enemy talks to me on a regular. That's why I've got to stay on my face and rebuke that rascal. Every voice that you hear is not the voice of God. As I began to struggle with that hater in my head, God rose up in my spirit and said, you're going to stand on the floor behind that little lectern and you're going to preach the word that I told you to preach. Listen, the people in that church, they were hungry for a move of the Holy Spirit. The people in that church, most of them were desperate for change. But the enemy, he didn't want this church to be delivered. So he was determined to use a mean deacon to get me caught up in my pride. Women of God, when I stood up and took that mic and opened my mouth and began to preach the word of God, the Holy Ghost fell and the power of God ran through that church like a raging wind. Even the mean old deacon was rejoicing. And after church, he came to the table and bought a book. Hey, Shabirabukasha. I'm a witness. When you get your pride out of the way, God will anoint you and he will use you. After that Sunday, I was invited back to that very church for 3 years in a row. And each time, they set me in the pulpit and I preached from the podium. W.O.T., don't allow your pride to keep you from soaring. Walk in wisdom and build your house. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for this lesson today. Oh God, we thank you that the grace and mercy that you continue to extend to us every day, we thank you for it, God. We ask you to please forgive us of every high and lofty spirit that we've embraced. Forgive us for operating in the spirit of offenses. Forgive us of all bitterness and unforgiveness that we harbor. Lord, help us to humble ourselves under your mighty hand. Lord, help us to love those who are hard to love. Help us, God, to forgive those who continue to hurt us. Help us, Jesus, to be more like you. And Lord, let us walk in wisdom. The wisdom that enables us to build our house. Make us to know your voice and to obey your every command as you lead and you guide us into all truth. It is in Jesus' name that we pray this prayer. We claim it done by faith. Amen. Women of Travail, your homework assignment for next week is to read chapters 18 and 16 in your Women of Travail book. I'm sorry, chapter 8 and chapter 16. Chapter 8 and chapter 16 in the Women of Travail Demon Slayer book. All right, I love you all so very much. Go in grace and peace, and may the Lord God continue to grant you divine favor. God bless you.
For tuning in to the Women of Travail. For merchandise such as the customized Born to Soar t-shirts and to stay updated with Women of Travail and the Face Down Prayer Movement, please visit our website at www.wotfd.com. If you were blessed by the word, please like our page, share our content, and donate via Cash App at Barbara A. Golder, Givelify at Women of Travail Face Down, or through the donate option on our website, WOTFD.com. We appreciate all of your continued support. See you next week via Facebook Live on Tuesday at 7 o'clock p.m. sharp for the next lesson of our Born to Soar series. Thanks again for tuning in.